everything, but like all the good stuff. You know, I want to make straight A's in school. I want to be able to work very hard and do excellent in my job. I want to keep a spotless house. I want to maintain quality relationships with my family and friends. I want to be able to serve in my church community. I also want to be able to serve in my local community with other nonprofits. So I end up having a very, very busy life. And there's a trap, I think, that it can be very easy for me to fall into. And that is when I find myself falling behind a little bit, and I find myself beginning to just kind of getting burnt out, I tend to try harder. So I will go home, and I'll beat myself up mentally. Joseph, no way, you can't do that. You're going to do better. And then I'm going to try again. I'm going to get out there, and I'm just going to do that. Now, I'm sure I'm probably the only one here like that, right? Every one of y'all are just chill, not too much stress in your life, not too many worries. We're a church of honesty, right? Anybody else struggle with this? Yeah. You know, I find it so interesting. You know, used to when people would ask you how you're doing, what was the response? Fine. I'm good. Now what is the response for most people? Busy. Or, depending upon the week, crazy busy, extra busy, extra busy, or slightly busy. But we're normally very, very busy people. And I think, you know, just in general, I mean, we're busy. I mean, you got to say you got a family with kids and both of the spouses are working and you're trying to keep a full-time stressful job going and then come home and you're cooking dinner and trying to feed the kids and make sure they don't kill each other and make sure they get to bed on time and you're following all the little books about how you're supposed to be doing things and then you get stressed out, right? And I think Christians, just going to be honest here, I think Christians struggle with this sometimes even more than secular people. Because not only do we want to do excellent in every area of our just regular life, we want to do really good in church too. And then we come and we hear a great sermon from Pastor Sam about the importance of God's word, and we're like, man, I'm going to do better in Bible reading. An extra 30 minutes a day. Here we go. And then we come and we hear another message on prayer, and we go back and we're like, oh God, I'm not doing good on prayer. I'm going to do better. I'm going to try harder, right? How many else has ever done that? And we tend to come into the Christian life, and the Christian life becomes a thing of trying harder. And we come to the end of the day, and we're tired. We're beat down. We might not mention it to anybody else because we got to keep up a good front, you know. Smile, everything. How are you, brother? Oh, I am fabulous. Blessed of the Lord. Hashtag blessed. Yeah? How many's ever been there? Yeah? We got to keep this up. But I think a lot of us wonder, is this the abundant life that God has called us to be living? And I would dare say no. I would dare say God has something better for us. And this message that I'm preaching today, God has literally been hammering me with this message over the past few weeks. Because this isn't a new thing. I want you to go in your Bibles with me. If you grab out your Bibles, whether you're going to tap over to Luke chapter 10, or whether you flip over there. We're going to be reading from a very familiar story, but I believe God wants to speak to us from this story. Luke chapter number 10, we're going to read starting in verse 38. Now as they went on their way, Jesus entered a village, and a woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to his teaching. But Martha was distracted with much serving. And she went up to him and said, Lord, Do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Tell her then to help me. But the Lord answered her, Martha, Martha, you are anxious and troubled about many things, but one thing is necessary. Mary has chosen the good portion which will not be taken away from her. Talk about opposites. Within one family, I have 10 siblings, and my mom said she thought we couldn't get different until we had like another one join us, and then she's like, whoa, these kids are different. We have these opposites of Mary and Martha. They're like daylight and dark. You know, Martha's like the thunder, and Mary's like the sunshine. You know, Martha's like the raging locomotive, you know, and Martha's like that, and Mary is like, you know, the little choo-choo train, you know? They seem so completely opposite. It's a story of contrast. And I don't know about you, but I identify with Martha. I mean, here you think about Jesus coming with his disciples. So this isn't just Jesus, but Jesus and his disciples. So we've got a crowd of 13 people, and they didn't have texting back in that day to text ahead and say, hey, ETA, 30 minutes out. No, Jesus shows up in the village, and guess whose house he comes to? Martha. So Martha, being the gracious lady that she was, opens her door, and you know, at first it's like, freak out, yeah, and it's like, oh, hi, Jesus. And she is a very generous and kind person. She wants to do everything well. So she sees Jesus with, you know, possibly 12 people. Maybe if the other, the context of previous scriptures are there, Jesus may have had 70. So we're talking about a big group of people here. And they all come into Martha's house. Now Martha, mind you, she has a very prestigious place, no doubt, in the society based upon what other things we know about her. So she has to do this really well. You know, so she's going through, can we do a soup? No, no soup for Jesus. We've got to do the best. So we're going to go out and have the, you know, the servant go kill a lamb, and I'm going to go grab all the extra vegetables, and we're going to be cooking and chopping, and we got to get the napkins and the placemats and everything set, get Jesus in there into the living room. And she's running through, and she's thinking, oh, no, Jesus might be staying the night. Well, we've got to get the beds ready. Where is Mary? As she rushes past, she's asking servants, where is Mary? Mary's nowhere to be found. So Martha is just, you know, she is an administrative person deluxe. She's got this, but she's going 90 miles an hour through the house, and she's wondering where Mary's at, and all of a sudden she slides past the door where Jesus is. She looks in, and she steps back, and who is sitting there on the floor in front of Jesus? It's Mary. So now I imagine Martha at this point is going, you know, clearing the throat, giving the evil eye in there at Mary. That doesn't work. So finally, she's like, barges in there and like, Jesus, hey, sorry to interrupt your little session here. You know, we're busy in here and we need Mary's help. Why isn't she in here helping me? How many's ever felt like that? Okay, so if you're really, you know, one of these hard worker kind of people, those of you that aren't, okay, relax, chill, I'll tell you what it's like. You see, you are working so hard, and you see five people sitting down doing nothing, and you're like, excuse me, here I am working, and you're sitting. There's something wrong with this picture, right? And Jesus, instead of doing what Martha expected, Jesus said, Martha, you're careful and troubled about many things, but one thing is necessary. Now we have this strange dichotomy here. Is Jesus saying that it's wrong to be serving? Is that what Jesus is saying? Is he presenting serving people and serving, serving as a bad thing, as opposed to sitting as a good thing? No. That's not what Jesus is saying. Jesus isn't presenting a dichotomy between work and worship. But what Jesus is trying to say here is that there's a problem with the heart. There's a problem with the heart. You see, as we look in this passage of Scripture, here in the same chapter, just before this, at the beginning of the chapter, Jesus sends his disciples out to go and to spread the gospel. So he sends them out to serve, okay? So we get this deal that Jesus calls us to serve. Immediately following that, we have the story of the Good Samaritan. So right before the story of Mary and Martha, we have the story of the Good Samaritan, where Jesus says, hey, if you're really truly a follower of mine, you're going to show compassion on others. So you're going to act. You're going to serve. So Jesus isn't trying to say service is bad. In fact, Jesus, the Bible says, came to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. That's in Mark chapter 10. So if Jesus is our example, serves, and he calls us to serve, why does he rebuke Martha? Why does he come to Martha and seemingly to chide her over her service as if she was doing something that she ought not to be doing? You see, I think here Martha opened her home to Jesus out of a well-intentioned heart, but she didn't open up her heart to Jesus. She opened her home, but not necessarily her heart. She wanted to do things for Jesus, but she didn't quite have the time to get to know Jesus. And I think this is where our churches, not just Loft, but in general, our American Western church is at. We a lot of times want to do things for Jesus. We are going to read our Bible. We're going to try extra hard, you know. Stop. Signed up for a new Bible reading plan, you know. Share it with all my friends. I'm going to do things for Jesus. And they're not bad things. We're called to do them. But we don't take the time to get to know Jesus. You see, there is a difference between just a servant and a disciple. A servant of God simply does his duty for God, whereas a disciple desires the delight of the Savior. A servant maintains his distance from God. You know, he does his religious duty. He comes and he maintains a respectful place to God. The disciple wants to come up and get just as close to God as he or she can. The servant burns out quickly, whereas the disciple abides eternally. Servants work for God, but disciples work with God. And I have to ask you, as God has been asking me, which category do I fit the most into? Do I fit the most into just a servant of God? Yes, I love God. Yes, I want to do the good things, but I maintain my distance from God. I try extra hard. I keep trying harder and harder and harder. I want to present to you today that we shouldn't just try harder. We should draw closer. This is my point today. This is what I want you to take home. We shouldn't just try harder to perform for God. We should draw closer to Him. And as we draw closer to God, we will be in a place that we can be able to serve appropriately for God. You see, I noticed a few things here in this passage. It's not a matter of personality. It's a matter of priority. You see, I like that Jesus didn't say to Martha, "Martha, Martha, why can't you be more like your sister Mary?" That's not what Jesus said. Instead, Jesus addressed Martha directly. He knew that Martha would never become Mary. Martha would probably always demonstrate her love for the Lord by her acts of service for him. He knew that. But he was not just addressing her service as much as he was addressing her distraction. Her priorities had got mixed up. And I think this is where I can so many times mess up, is my priorities can get out of line and I can begin to do all these grand things for God without truly spending that time with God that should be my number one priority. You see, it's the better part that Jesus is speaking of here. Jesus said, one thing is needful. That part is available to both kinds of people. So if you're here today and you're a Martha type and you're feeling really down right now, you're like, oh no, I'm just really bad. Don't feel bad. We need you. In fact, I think a lot of churches, if they don't have their Marthas around, they're going down. Because Marthas get things done. And we need Marthas. We also need Marys. Marys, those sweet, lovable people that just want to smile and be really nice to people and just want to sit down and talk with them through their problems. We need those people too. We need everyone, and God has put us all together for a reason. So it's not a matter of your personality, it's a matter of your priority. Where is your focus? It's also not a matter of your ability, but it's a matter of your humility. You see, Martha comes into this situation, and she really wants to kind of guilt trip Jesus. You know, it's like Jesus didn't notice that Mary was there. Because, by the way, this was not a socially acceptable thing. Mary should never have been in the area with the other guys. She stays far away. It was a woman's place to stay far away from Jesus, or far away from the rabbis. But that was not Jesus' idea. Jesus welcomed her to come close to him. And Martha wants to kind of guilt trip Jesus into saying that Mary should, you know, go back, abide by the social standards. But no, Jesus says, Martha, don't you get it? I'm not going to be here very long. And you're more worried about fixing a meal than you are about preparing your heart to be open. You're all up on your high and mighty horse of trying to make sure everything of your image stays in place as the perfect hostess in Bethany. Whereas Jesus wanted her heart. So it's not a matter just of our ability, but it's a matter of our humility. It's also not a matter of our activity or how much we are doing, but it's a matter of our identity. How do we view ourselves in relation to God? I love what Mary did. Mary comes, and I imagine she probably started out first serving. You know, she probably was taking the coats and being really nice and doing the things. But as she started to hear Jesus' words, something was awakened within her heart. That there was something more to her life than just living this dull, drudgery life of service that she had been living. She wanted to know this man. She wanted to hear what he had to say. And I think almost instinctively, maybe she didn't even realize what she's doing, she's walking closer and closer and closer and closer until finally she's right up close to Jesus. She realizes that Jesus wants her identity to be found in him, not in her work. Martha still hadn't got that figured out. Martha's identity was still very much found in what she could do for Jesus. And out of a very good heart, her identity was as a servant. She was this courageous servant that was willing to do whatever needed to be done, but without the love relationship. But I believe that God called Martha, just as he's calling us today, to come close, to draw near, to not just try harder, but to draw closer. Could it be that Martha was kind of scared? And there were some things about herself she didn't quite understand. She didn't want to have to deal with, and she didn't once exposed to Jesus. I think that oftentimes keeps a lot of us away. But if we will realize our true identity is to be found in Him, not in what we do, I believe that is where the abundant life will come in. You see, and in this passage of Scripture, we don't find out how it ends. It just kind of ends kind of abruptly. Jesus kind of scolds Martha in a very kind and tender tone. But it goes on. But we do find another instance of Martha in the New Testament. Over in John chapter 11, Martha's brother had died. She's in somewhat of a similar predicament in that she has a whole group of people in her home. She has all the Jews, they said. Many Jews came out to comfort them. And they're in Martha's home. Now, I'm going to be honest. Even at this time when her brother has died, Martha is still the administrator. Martha is still very much trying to figure everything out. She's got to keep things running. I know, I'll just speak for myself. And even in a difficult situation, some of the difficult things, I'm going to keep strong and I'm going to keep everything going. But I like what Martha does there. Martha hears that Jesus is coming. And Martha leaves her reputation as the perfect hostess. And it's the place where she was seated with all the people surrounding her. And she goes to meet Jesus. Comes up close to Jesus. And she testifies to Jesus in John chapter 11, verse 27. She says, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God." She comes close. She comes near. I ask each of you today, is there a hunger within you for something more? You've been trying harder to do all the good things, all the right things that you know you should be doing, and you find yourself empty and tired of it. I find myself there, tired of working and working and working. Are you tired of just head knowledge of God, and you want to know God? You want to draw near to God. That's a desire that He wants to satisfy. So I want to challenge us with something very practical. I want everybody to listen. If you went to sleep, I hope you can wake back up. Turn to your neighbor and say, "Wake up." Okay. I want you to do something for me this next week. I want you to find at least 1 hour this next week, and I want you to get alone with just you and God, and I want you to ask God, what does it mean for me to draw near to you? What does it mean for my life, personally, for me to come close to you? 1 hour. For some of you, you think, "There's no hours in my day. I can't do this." I encourage you to find the time. Maybe it's a mom that has to say, "Dad, can you watch the kids for a couple of hours? I'm going to go to Starbucks, and I'm going to sit there, and I'm going to pray." Maybe it's a dad that has to get up an hour extra early in the morning before everybody's awake. And he goes out to the garage and finds a stool to sit down on and pray and talk to God. Maybe it's a student that has to leave their books behind, leave their room, and go to a park and get alone with God for an hour and ask God, "God, what does it mean for me personally to get to know you?" And then I encourage you to follow that up with doing whatever God calls you to do. I encourage you, whenever you take that time, to take something you can write with and to write down what God speaks to your heart, because I believe God will speak something to your heart. if you will have ears to be open to hear it. And I want you to imagine with me what would happen, not just in this church, but in our community, if people see a group of Christians that love God, that are not just trying harder to please God, but that are truly drawing closer in intimate relationship with God. What will happen in this community? I believe there will be a great attraction of people to Christ because of this. Because people are searching for something deeper than just trying harder. They're tired. Our world is tired of just trying harder and coming and doing more things to try to earn better and greater. I believe God is calling us to this. And you see, this is the message of the gospel. The message of the gospel is that salvation is not just about us trying harder. Salvation is about what Jesus did for us. And in just a few moments, we're going to come up and we're going to take communion together. And as we take communion, communion is this reminder of intimate relationship with Jesus. Whenever Jesus had this night, when he instituted the thing of communion, it was a time of closeness with him and his disciples. And this is what God wants us to be for each of us. To come close to God. To not just try harder to please God. Try harder to perform for God. But to draw nearer to God. The one thing this morning that I want you to remember is don't just try harder. Draw closer. And that may mean different things for different ones of you. But I encourage you, as you take an hour this week, at least an hour, maybe for some of you, you can take 4 hours or more, and you can just get alone with God. It's amazing. I'll tell you, God has done that within my heart just over the last couple of weeks. I took some time away, and God really worked in my heart. But it took a few hours, honestly, for me to get out of my crazy trying to plan and keep everything going to just settle before God. So whatever it takes you, I encourage you to take that time and to act upon what God says. And the way we do communion here at Loft is that when you're ready, as the worship team sings, you can come up the aisles. You'll be able to take the elements. You can either dip the cracker into the juice, or you can take a cup if you prefer that. And before you come, I ask you, this is also a time of repentance. There may be people here today that you don't know God. And you realize today, I've been trying hard to live a religious life, but I don't know God. I want to know Him. There's that spark within you that says that. I encourage you today to trust Jesus as your Savior. We'll have people in the back of our building here that are glad to pray with you. And we encourage you to go to them. Or you may be here today and you know God, but you feel like Martha, a little distracted right now. I encourage you, don't just try harder. Draw. Come closer. Dear God, we come before you. And I admit, Lord, in front of this group of family, this faith family, that I need you. I admit that I have often tried harder in an effort to be all that I should be. I've worked hard. As the song we sang earlier, I worked my fingers down to the bone, trying hard to atone for myself. But God, it's not about me. It's about you. God, and I pray that in the hearts of each of these gathered here today, that there would be a drawing of the Holy Spirit within them that would draw them unto you, O Lord. That wherever there is distraction, wherever there is things that have clouded out their focus, God, that they would draw near and that they would come close. That they would forsake the life of just trying harder and that would instead draw closer. God, speak to us today as we come for communion to remember your sacrifice and to remember your call. As you said, come unto me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest for your souls, for my yoke my burden is light. Issue that call to us today.